Well, hello everybody, my name is Marie-José Bonthuis and I'm going to tell you something in this lecture, this mini lecture, about 10 minutes about pseudonymization and anonymization. Well, as I said, it's about pseudonymization and anonymization, and what the difference is I will come to in the end. And we're talking, of course, about these two subjects in the context of health research. Well, again, my name is Marie-José Bonthuis. I'm a privacy / IT lawyer for the UMGG. I'm an external IT lawyer, and I am the external DPO, the data protection officer of the Medical Biobank Lifelines here in Groningen in the Netherlands. And I am recording this presentation in July 2020. But first, anonymization and pseudonymization is not a static thing. It's not that you do it once and then it's forever anonymized or pseudonymized. What the difference is what I'm going to explain later. But it's a dynamic process. And what can be anonymized now cannot be in a few years later. It depends on a lot of factors, for instance, and what kind of data is available in the surrounding, and what kind of techniques do we have to re-identify the data, etc., etc. So we have to consider it as a dynamic process. And the second thing is that it's not an aim to anonymize or pseudonymize the data, but you have to see it as a security measure to reduce the risk of re-identification. Mouthful, but that is what how you should look at it. But because what is very important is that you can still, that you have to think about the usability of the data. If you consider it as an aim to anonymize or pseudonymize as much as you can, then the usability of the data is can become a problem. So that is, of course, always the main goal that you have, the main aim that you have, that you have to do good qualified scientific research with a security measure to reduce the risk of re-identification. That is important. Okay, and how do we anonymize or pseudonymize data? Well, there was still a very important opinion of the Working Party 29, Article 29 Working Party, or now known as the EDPB, the European Data Protection Board, and that has three criteria. First, you have to say something about the singling out, and that means that how unique are the identifiers in your data set. Can I, with a combination of some unique identifiers, can I re-identify a person? And so how many unique identifiers do I have? And the second thing is what you need is how linkable is it? Because if you don't have access to additional information where you can re-identify, then it can also be well pseudonymized. For instance, you'll only have a date of birth and a disease, but because you also have access to the electronic health records where the name is in and the date of birth and the disease, then you can, based on the singling out mechanism, link them to the additional information, and so you can re-identify. We call that indirect identifiability. And the third topic that we're going to talk about, where a lot of jurisprudence is about, is who can re-identify. What is the role of the user, and how capable is he to re-identify the person or the data subject? So the first topic that we are going to dive a little bit in is the singling out mechanism. And so if we summarize the GDPR, then you can consider that personal data is direct or indirect identifiable. And if it's not direct or indirect identifiable, then it is anonymized. But what you do with pseudonymization can be both. And we consider that pseudonymized data can be indirect identifiable, but you can do it on a proper manner that you can also consider it as anonymized. And what we always thought is that if we remove the direct identifiable information of a data set, then it is anonymized. And that is what we now consider too short, because the data can still be indirect identifiable. So this is very important to measure how indirect identifiable your data set is. The pseudonymization can still be indirect identifiable, and if it's not indirect identifiable anymore, then it can be anonymized. That is the red thread in my talk in bad English, in good Dutch, I think. So generalization and suppressing is what we are going to discuss later on, but first of all, we are going to deep a little bit dive in this. This is an example of an algorithm that is called K-anonymity. And a PhD in the Netherlands investigated the indirect identifiability of a data set of the municipality. And he investigated it with now a little bit more than 3 million records of all the citizens in the Netherlands. And what this algorithm does, and it's developed in Harvard by LaTanya Sweeney, did investigation with it. What this algorithm is doing is that it makes a list of all the possible combinations that can be found in such a data set. And so the list is, of course, way longer than I show you now, but for the example, it's good enough. So in the registration of the municipality of all the Dutch citizens, you can see a postcode of 4, a postcode of 6. You can make a combination of a postcode of 4 and a date of birth, a postcode of 6, date of birth, etc., etc. And so this list creates insight of how many possible combinations you can make. And then it's interesting to see that and that algorithm is counting how many different variations of a postcode of 4 can I see in that data set. And then you can see that there are only 388 variations of a postal code of 4. And that is a very small number, and that is, I think, a good thing, because then the groups are very large. And so that is the other way around thinking. But small groups is good in a set of 3.3 million records, because then the risk that you can be re-identified by only the postal code of 4 is very low. And because this number is very low, so the groups are very high, so the fact that you can only re-identify me with the postcode of 4 is very low. But with the postcode of 6, the groups are becoming a little bit smaller, because this number is increasing, only almost 67,000 variations of postcode of 6. And what you can see, and that was a really big shock in the world, that the combination postal code of 4 and date of birth is almost 2.3 million different variations in a general set of citizens. So what does it say? Well, this says a lot of things, that if you have an additional or an other data set where also the postal code of 4 and the date of birth is in, for example, our electronic health record, and then you can immediately re-identify 2.2 million, more than 2.2 million of those people. And there's another interesting part, and the fact that there are a lot of ones in this row, that means that most of the 2.3 million groups are single records. Yeah? So they're groups of one. K is one, as we can say. So with this mathematics, we can see that that the postcode of 4 and date of birth is, for a high percentage, indirect identifiable. But what you need is an additional data set where we can have the name. And that is what is called linkability. Hey, you have to be capable to link and the postcode for and the date of birth to another set where the name is in. And this is very important. So if you have a unique combination, but it is not linkable to anything else, then it's a good thing for to become anonymized. And then this is maybe the most complex part of this presentation. Then who can we identify? And what we use in health context as well, a lot is an organization that is called a trusted third party, an independent technical partner. If we have a source A and a source B and they want to link two data sets together, but they don't want to share each other's data, then you participate or then you contract a TTP. And what this TTP is doing is a double pseudonymization. It pseudonymized data in the source, at the source. So this becomes irreducible for each other. And also for the TTP, and then you load it up, the pseudonymized data, and then it gets the second pseudonymization. And what the TTP can see is only numbers instead of direct identifiable information, but they can see that the what the overlap is in A and B. So if you need all the patients of A that are also in data set B, then the TTP knows where the overlap is, but doesn't know who is involved. And this is a very interesting structure and mechanism to pseudonymize in a way that is then it becomes very compliant to law. In fact, there's huge discussion about it, but I'm going to explain that later. Well, there are some techniques, and I'm going to flip back a little to the first picture that I showed you. Because what can you do if you have a very high amount of singling out? And it is linkable to other additional data sets. Then there are some techniques that you can do. And the first is generalization. And you can see this is not very up to date anymore, but for the example, doesn't matter. And so the whole date of birth, if you don't need the whole date of birth, you can also say, well, you only get the age. And then you're generalize the data to 42. And you can see, you can understand that if we do the math again, and then this is not a date of birth anymore, but an age. And then the groups are getting a little bit smaller, is the expectation. But what you can also do is suppress the data. And so instead of the whole postal code of 6, you can make, you can leave the two characters behind and maybe generalize the postal code to 9700. This is what you can do. And there are some other techniques as well. Randomization of the data set, you can shuffle them, and that name and a fictive name is connected to another date of birth, etc. That's a technique that you can do. And you can generalize, which I already explained. And there's two technical techniques. And that is hashing. And that is most of the time one-way hashing. And that is a method to make a large number of digits instead of readable data. And this is to be considered as probably anonymized. But most of the times we encrypt the data and there's some key. And that is very important because this technique, pseudonymization by encryption, always has a secret key. And then it is very important who has that key. Because if it is the controller who has the secret encryption key, then for the controller, the data never can be anonymized because they can de-identify the data. Or de-identify and re-identify it again because they also have the key. And then it depends if the trusted third party has the key, if you are able as a controller or user to claim that key and ask for the key. And most of the time, TTP's contractual forbids to ask for the key. Well, then we have a very good way of pseudonymization, because A cannot re-identify B, also not, and the TTP also does not have any clue about what person data subject is about. So this could be a very clever way to pseudonymize your data in a way that you can consider it as anonymized. I hope you enjoyed this mini lecture. If you have questions or you would like to have more info, feel free to contact me. Here's my contact information. You can email me, look at the website, or pick up the phone. I hope to see you soon later. Bye-bye.